person and on Facebook Live, would you stand to your feet? How many came ready to give honor to Jesus, the one who is the real reason for the season? I'm so thankful that he came. So come on and sing with us, Joy to the World. Come on and sing that with us. When we think about this time of year, there should be one main focus, and that's Jesus. Amen. It's all about Him. It's all about Jesus. He came. He came to this earth just for us. He came because of His great love just for us. He came to make a way for us when there was no way. He came so we could be back into right standing with God. He came so we didn't have to be in bondage anymore. He came so we didn't have to be in sin anymore. He came so we didn't have to pay the price for our own sin. He came because He loved us. He came to heal the brokenhearted. He came to mend the sick. He came to open blind eyes. He came to make deaf ears hear. Jesus came. Amen. And that's what Christmas is all about. So just take a moment to think about that, that the God of the heavens sent His only Son just for you. He stepped out of glory for you. He knew what was going to happen. He paid the ultimate price. He didn't just quit halfway or take the easy way out. But Jesus is a mighty warrior that came for you and for me, and He is worthy of our worship this morning. He is deserving to take a moment and lift up your hands and say, Lord, I love You so much. I thank You for this season. I thank You as we remember Your birth in that manger. Just for me, You came. So I want to encourage you, whether you're at home watching on Facebook Live or you're right here in the sanctuary, to put everything out of your mind that you have to do this week, because I know it's a busy week, and just focus on Jesus and say, thank You for coming. Thank You for being my Savior. He is wonderful. He is Counselor. He's the mighty God. He's the everlasting Father, the Prince of Peace. Amen.
Oh, come, all ye faithful, joyful and triumphant. Oh, come, oh, come to Bethlehem. Come and behold. Oh, come.
of your worship. He truly is the King of Kings. He is the Lord of all lords. And I am so thankful that he came. Amen. Well, I'm so glad y'all are here today celebrating this very special time of year, Christmas. So good to see all of you. Before you're seated, why don't you find a few people around you to wave to, smile, say Merry Christmas.
Hey, Merry Christmas, everybody. Come on, look at your neighbor and tell them Merry Christmas. Come on, tell your other neighbor Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas.
Babe, I'm looking at some sweaters. I'm not going to say they're ugly sweaters, but they're amazing sweaters.
I'm looking over here at Clarice's.
Come on, Clarice, stand up. I know you hate attention. Would you please show everybody that beautiful penguin?
That's nice.
I like that one. And Naomi, come on, stand up and let everybody see yours. You got lights on and turn around and show that thing off. Come on, girl.
She got a fancy one.
I love it. I love it. I love Christmas, man. We're having all kind of fun with the kids. And we just can't say thanks enough for you guys braving this crazy weather to come out. Now, I warned y'all last week, Darcy. I told you, weathermen are the only people who can get it wrong and everybody still keeps them. So they called for 12 inches of snow. And in my house, we got 40, so all right.
How many of you liked the snow? Wasn't it awesome? How many had animals to feed? And you were like, I don't know if they really need to eat. Was I the only one that thought that? I was like, that's kind of far out there. But we fed them.
Ours did get fed.
We did feed them.
Yeah, absolutely. But I gave up. You know, me and Marsha were really ambitious, and we had shoveled all day on a bunch of stuff. I was on the barn roof and shoveling the driveway and the cars.
Which he almost fell off. He almost fell off the barn roof, like, by 1 second. It was like the movies where they, like, and then they catch themselves. That's what he did. So good. We're thankful that he's here today in one piece.
Cat-like reflexes.
I don't know if I would say that. That's not exactly what I saw.
But what I was saying was we were really ambitious, and we were like going down to the mailbox in PennDOT. We love them. Thank God for them. They plowed my mailbox into a snowdrift. So if you work for PennDOT, we're so appreciative of all your hard work. But we went down there. We're going to cut it out. And we got down there and looked at it. And we're like, nope, bye. We'll just pick up our mail at the post office. But anyway, we hope you guys are having a great week. And we're thrilled that you've joined us to kick off this Christmas week. And we appreciate so much you being here in person with us. And to all of you who are online with us right now on Facebook Live, thank you from the bottom of our hearts. Can y'all just give God praise that we're worshiping together this morning?
And we need your help right now. If you could share this service right now, get your phones out, share. People need to hear the message of Jesus Christ. It's the gospel. It's good news. And if you're watching online, you share too. Share to anybody, your coworkers, your friends, anybody that you could think of that would need to hear the gospel of Jesus and his incredible story. And you all are doing so good at sharing. I'm so proud of you. You guys are sharing like, I don't even know, like crazy share.
That's through the roof. I mean, the views from last week's message alone are like almost 10,000, 9.8.
And that's crazy, and that's all because of y'all doing it.
Yeah, absolutely.
You guys are sharing the gospel, and we are so appreciative. Thank you. Keep up the good work.
So in 2020, the kingdom's going forward. Do me a favor. I know it seems like a kind of a superficial deal and not really that important, but if you have not liked and followed us yet, Victory Church Troy, PA, please do that. Here's why. We need your help to share the love of Jesus with as many people as possible. It's an odd time we're living in, and many people are not yet comfortable coming out. It's a super easy way for you guys to share the gospel. So if you would help us do that, we would sure appreciate it.
Absolutely. Well, if you're visiting with us for the first time, we are so grateful that you are here with us this morning. Victory, you make them feel welcome.
Yeah.
If that's you and this is your very first time here, if you would just do me a quick favor, just raise up your hand just so the ushers can see you. They're not going to call you out. They're not going to embarrass you. They just want to make their way towards you, give you a connection card and a pen. If you could take that pen, fill that card out real quick, drop it in the offering plate here in just a moment. We'd greatly appreciate it. And if you're joining us for the first time on Facebook Live, we would love to hear from you too. All you have to do is type the word connect in the bar down below and someone someone's going to reach out to you.
Absolutely. We want to challenge you if you are visiting with us today. Number one, welcome home. Number two, please take the four-week test drive. Yes. We call it at Victory. I promise you won't regret it. Kick the tires. Find out what we're all about. You're going to be so blessed in your own walk with God. And God's also going to speak to your heart, not only about your relationship with Him, but about your relationship with others. One of the ways we grow best with the Lord is when we connect to others. The church you choose is one of the most important decisions you'll ever make, simply because you are who you hang with. We're not perfect, but we promise to always give you nothing less than our best. We call this God's living room because that's where life happens, and we're thrilled to do life with you. For many of us, you know, this is more family than our own DNA. So one more time, Victory, would you let our guests know how much we appreciate them? Thanks for coming. We also have a gift for you. If you are visiting today, right out through the double doors in the lobby to the left, there's a beautiful cafe, and there's some great people that would love to give you something really nice just to say thanks. We never want to waste your time when you come to Victory Church. You know, this time of year, we talk about generosity a lot. We talk about giving a lot. And that all comes from God's initial original gift. John 3:16, for God so loved the world that he
gave.
What did he do?
He gave.
He gave. For God so loved the world that he. It was God's love that prompted the most amazing gift we could ever receive. And that was his son, Jesus Christ. God didn't give us Jesus because he had to, Vanessa. He gave us Jesus because he wanted to. And that's what love does. When you go to a birthday party, Uncle Jim, and you take a gift, you don't take a gift because you have to. Well, I guess it depends on who it's for. You take a gift because you want to, and you get great joy out of seeing them receive that gift. And so, you know, a lot of times I know at Christmas and Easter, we've got guests and people that are new to God's house, and coming to church isn't really your thing, but you're here today and you're watching online, and we're thrilled that you're with us this morning. I just want to explain to you, because so much of the time in the world, it's like you got to get something to give something. And it's confusing, and people are like, well, what? Why is money important, or why is there even talk about money? It's very simply because Jesus spent so much time talking about this fact, about money. And I want you to know today at Victory Church, nobody gives because they have to. We give because we can't help it. We give because of what God gave to us. And that's what it comes down to. His generosity changed our life. We give because we want to. Because when God's love is deposited in your heart, you want to help somebody else hear the same message that impacted your life and improved your life. How many of y'all can say my life is better because of what Jesus has done?
Yes.
Come on, let me hear from you. Could you give God praise this morning? And so here's the thing. Jesus lived to give, and we do the exact same thing. He said, freely you've received, freely go and give. And so I want you to know today that generosity changes lives. It changes yours first, changes other people second. He said in Acts chapter 20, verse 35, it says, and remember the words of the Lord Jesus that he said, it's more blessed. Somebody say more blessed.
More.
I like to say it like this, more blessed. It's more blessed to give than to receive. The greater blessing belongs to the giver. And once you realize that and you get the joy of giving and making a difference, if you've ever done something for somebody else, man, it unlocks something on the inside of you that is just undeniable and that is irreplaceable. And I want you to know today, we are more blessed because of God's great gift that he sent in Jesus Christ. Generosity changed our life. And through your generosity, Victory Church, this year, we have had such a huge impact in our community, in our region, and around the world. And I thank God for that. I thank God for you. Let's keep being champions the next 2 weeks. And God is going to do great things, not only in your house, but through your giving to this house. Amen. As you get your offering in your hand, let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father, we thank you right now. We come to you with many gifts, but we bring one offering. And as we give it to you today, we do it in love. We do it full of joy. We do it because we want to, not because we have to. We're not trying to buy a blessing, but we're giving because we're blessed. And we say thank you, Jesus, today for everything you've done for us, for everything you've done in us, for the things you've done through each of us individually and corporately this year. I pray that you meet every need according to your riches and glory by Christ Jesus. For those who are struggling financially this year, I thank you for showing up in a mighty way this year. I thank you that faith will replace fear. And Father, I praise you. I declare that you are Lord over each and every one of our lives. And you're our shepherd, and we shall not want. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. And everybody said,
amen.
Be blessed while you give.
Feliz Navidad. Feliz Navidad. Prospero año y felicidad. Everybody! I wanna wish you a Merry Christmas. I wanna wish you a Merry Christmas. I wanna wish you a Merry Christmas from the bottom of my heart. I wanna wish you a Merry Christmas. I wanna wish you a Merry Christmas. I wanna wish you a Merry Christmas from the bottom of my heart.
Never gets old. I love it. Great job. Would y'all let the worship team know how much you love them today and appreciate them? That was smoking. Thank you, guys and girls. And I just want to say thanks to all of our grip help, the men and women who help get everything set on the platform. Would y'all let our AVL team know how much we appreciate them today? Actually, if one of you guys would make sure Anna gets her microphone, that would be, oh, there you go, right there. So I've asked that Marsha and the girls come help me today. We're going to read the Christmas story. You'll shoot your eye out. No, not that Christmas story. We're going to read the OG Christmas story with you. I hope that's okay with you today. We can never take for granted the importance of taking a moment to just go back to what originally happened at Christmas. A lot of times we assume people know. And what I found out is that I don't make assumptions anymore, because a lot of people don't know. And so I love, love, love taking time to read this. And this is the first time we've done it that you're going to be helping us read. Are you excited, Zoe, about Christmas?
Yes.
Why are you excited? What is most exciting for you about Christmas? Presents? No! The cookies. Advent calendar. Every single day, what do? You get up and what happens?
Advent calendar.
So what does that mean? Like, you go get what?
Toys.
So mommy has a clue and you go on this big search through the house looking for stuff and she's hidden something for you somewhere? Yeah. That's pretty fun. Okay. Is there anything specific you want for Christmas that you want Santa to know about? Nothing you want to remind him of? Okay, all right. What about you, Anna?
Easy.
I want some warmer weather.
Warmer weather, hallelujah, I've raised her right. Absolutely. You don't have to shovel sunshine. What else?
I want the things for Odie, my new horse.
Like what? What do you want for your new horse?
I need some bell boots for it.
Think big.
Bigger. They're saying bigger.
Shut up, Chris. I need some bell boots for it for when I go sliding down the arena.
So Uncle Chris is going to pay for it.
I need some Romel Reigns that I'm asking
okay.
for.
Okay.
Man, she's got
We'll see what shows up under the tree. What about you, babe?
I was wondering if you were going to ask me, because the last time we sat up here as a family of four, remember I asked for an alpaca? And he was like, no. Well, guess who has two alpacas? Right here. So I was trying to think of something really big. I was going to think big. So
I want a miniature cow.
If I see Santa, I'm going to punch him right in the throat.
I'll take a miniature cow.
So, of course,
then.
I'll take another animal.
He overrode me.
I'll take an animal.
A miniature cow.
A miniature cow. No. So let's jump into the story today. and we're going to read it together family style. That okay with you guys? All right, here we go. The Bible says in Matthew chapter 1, verse 18, it says, this is how Jesus the Messiah was born. His mother Mary was engaged to be married to Joseph. But before the marriage took place, while she was still a virgin, she became pregnant through the power of the Holy Spirit. Joseph, her fiancé, was a good man and did not want to disgrace her publicly. So he decided to break the engagement quietly.
As he considered this, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream. Joseph, son of David, the angel said, do not be afraid to take Mary as your wife, for the child within her was conceived by the Holy Spirit, and she will have a son, and you are to name him Jesus, for he will save his people from their sins.
That's one of the most powerful verses in the entire
New
Testament. Verse 22 says, all of this occurred to fulfill the Lord's message through his prophet. Look, the virgin will conceive a child, and she'll give birth to a son, and they'll call him Emmanuel, which means God with us.
Now in the sixth month, the angel Gabriel was sent by God to a city of Galilee named Nazareth, to a virgin betrothed to a man whose name was Joseph, of the house of David. The virgin's name was Mary.
And having come in, the angel said to her, rejoice, highly favored one, the Lord is with you. Blessed are you among women. But when she saw him, she was troubled at his saying and concerned what manner of greeting this was. Then the angel said to her, do not be afraid, Mary, you have found favor with God. And behold, you will conceive in womb and bring forth a son, and shall call his name Jesus. He will be great, and he will be called the Son of the Highest. Then Mary said to the angel, how can this be, since I do not know a man? And the angel answered and said to her, the Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Highest will overshadow you. Therefore also that Holy One who is to be born will be called the Son of God, for with God nothing will be impossible.
That's one of my favorite verses in the whole Bible right there. With God nothing will be impossible. The Bible says in Luke chapter 2, at that time the Roman Emperor Augustus decreed that a census should be taken throughout the Roman Empire. This was the first census taken when Quirinius was governor of Syria. All returned to their own ancestral towns to register for this census. And because Joseph was a descendant of King David, you remember King David? He was in the Old Testament. There was a story about him, and he went out with five stones and a slingshot. You remember who he took out?
Goliath.
Goliath. All right. King David, he had to go to Bethlehem in Judea, David's ancient home, and he traveled there from the village of Nazareth in Galilee. He took with him Mary, his fiancée, who is now obviously pregnant.
There was no room for them in the inn.
That's quite the part, babe.
I know,
I'm feeling kind of bad why they only gave me that one. Yeah, he's not kidding.
And when while they were there, the time came for her baby to be born. She gave birth to her first child, a son. She wrapped him in snuggly strips and cloth and laid him in a manger.
That night, there were shepherds staying in the fields nearby, guarding their flocks of sheep. Suddenly, an angel of the Lord appeared among them, and the radiance of the Lord's glory surrounded them. They were terrified, but the angel reassured them. Do not be afraid, he said. I bring you good news that will bring great joy to all people.
I like that angel.
The Savior, yes, the Messiah, the Lord, has been born today in Bethlehem, the city of David. And you will recognize him by this sign. You will find a baby wrapped snugly in strips of cloth lying in a manger. Suddenly the angel was joined by a vast host of others, the armies of heaven, praising God and saying, glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace, goodwill toward men.
Nice job. Can you imagine that if angels just appeared when you went out to do chores one night? Wow.
When the angels had returned to heaven, the shepherds said to each other, let's go to Bethlehem. Let's see this thing that has happened. They're saying, let's go see what happened, right? And which the Lord has told us about. They hurried to the village and found Mary and Joseph, and there was the baby lying in the manger.
Imagine Jesus being born in a barn.
After seeing him, the shepherds told everyone what had happened and what the angel had said to them about this child. All who heard the shepherd's story was astounded. But Mary kept all these things in her heart and thought about them often.
Now, after Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea in the days of Herod the king, behold, wise men from the east came to Jerusalem, saying, where is he who has been born king of the Jews? For we have seen his star in the east and have come to worship him.
When Herod the king heard this, he was troubled, and all Jerusalem with him. And when he had gathered all the chief priests and scribes of the people together, he inquired of them where the Christ was to be born.
So they said to him, in Bethlehem of Judea, for thus it is written by the prophet, but you, Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, are not least among the rulers of Judah. For out of you shall come a ruler who will shepherd my people Israel.
Then Herod, when he had secretly called the wise men, determined from them what time the star appeared. And he sent to them to Bethlehem and said, go and search carefully for the young child. And when you have found him, bring back word to me that I may come and worship him also.
Paige.
When they heard the king, they departed, and behold, the star which they had seen in the east went before them till it came and stood over where the young child was. When they saw the star, that they rejoiced with exceedingly great joy.
It's quite the engineering.
And when they had come into the house, they saw the young child with Mary his mother, and they fell down and worshipped him. And when they had opened their treasures, they presented gifts to him, gold, frankincense, and myrrh.
His life brought light to everyone. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness can never extinguish it. He came into the very world he created, but the world didn't recognize him. He came to his own people, and even they rejected him.
But to all who believed him and accepted him, he gave the right to become children of God. Aren't you thankful
yes.
for that? Verse 13, they are reborn not with a physical birth resulting from human passion or plan, but a birth that comes from God.
Amen. He was born so that we can be born again. If y'all are thankful for what Jesus did and that he came, would you get on your feet? Just give him praise and glory and honor right now. Amen. I want to ask you guys to join us in singing Away in a Manger.
No way in a manger, no crib for a bed. The little Lord Jesus laid down his sweet head. The stars in the sky look down where he lay. The little Lord Jesus asleep on the hay. The cattle are lowing, the baby awakes, but little Lord Jesus no crying he makes. I love thee, Lord Jesus, look down from the sky and stay by my cradle till morning. I ask thee to stay close by me forever and love me, I pray. Bless all the dear children in thy tender care and fit us for heaven to live with thee there.
You may be seated today. I want to say thanks again for joining us for worship this morning. A very special day as we celebrate Christmas. We celebrate the fact that Jesus came. I want to say thanks to Anna and Zoe and Marcia for helping me. Didn't the girls do a great job? Would you let them know how much you love them? And one of my favorite things about that story, and this is a real story, Jesus was a real person that came to this earth. We actually mark time by what life was like before he came and what life is like after. And I love what the angel said to the shepherds. They said this in Luke chapter 2, verse 10. They said, "Don't be afraid. I bring you good news." Everybody say good news. "I bring you good news that will bring great joy." He said, "I bring you good news that will bring you great joy to all people." And so the story of Christmas, the story of Jesus coming to this earth, is good news. Everybody say good news. And that good news produces joy in our hearts. And it's a simple message that anyone can understand, no matter how old you are today. It's so easy for us to grasp. And there's very simply three things I want to share with you today that the message of Jesus coming to this earth, the message of Christmas, says to each and every one of us. The first one is very simply this: God's message to you, somebody say he's talking to me, God's message to you is that God tells you, "I love you." That is the number one message of Christmas. When we give a gift, it sends a message. And God wanted you to get the message loud and clear. He was saying, "I love you." John 3:16, Colin says, "For God so loved the world." It doesn't just say loved. It says he loved us so much that he sent his only son, Jesus Christ. That he sent his only begotten son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, should not die, but have everlasting life. Well, I don't know about y'all, but that's good news. And sometimes we hear that so much that we just get used to it and we kind of build the callus to it. But there's nothing more incredible than the fact God says, "I'm going to eliminate death so that you can live." Even when you take your last breath on this earth and in this life, he says, "You're going to meet me in the next, and I'm going to be there to receive you, and I've prepared a place for you." Are y'all thankful today that Jesus has gone to prepare a place for you? Can you say amen this morning? But through the gift of Jesus Christ, Tyrone, God shows how crazy passionate he was about us. I mean, he wanted you to know how much he loves you. And that's one of the things I love doing with people is I love loving on people. And I know that sounds kind of weird. Some of y'all are going to kind of shy away from me now. But if you know me, you know I love to love on people. I love to be loved. I love to share love. You know, Marcia, I like her to smother me. What's too much for others, she's just getting started for me. And that's the way I like to be loved. And you know what? I like to share love. And I love that one of the ways I love to share love is complimenting people. And one of the things I've noticed is when I encourage somebody or when I compliment them, I've noticed the number of times that we discount that compliment. You know what I'm talking about? Or all of a sudden people get awkward if you compliment them, or we brush it off, or we act like we didn't hear it, or we doubt whether that person really meant what they were saying, or we say things like this: "Well, they were just trying to be nice." And you know what I'm talking about? And we have a hard time letting people love us. And it's that way with God too. We've got to let God love us. And that's what God says to us through the gift of his son, Jesus Christ. He says, "I love you." And he wants you to know that today. And here's the thing, y'all. God doesn't love us because of who we are. He loves us because of who he is. I like that. Because so many times in earthly love, it's conditional. "I'll love you if." But God doesn't say, "I love you if." He says, "I love you, period." The Bible in 1 John says that God is love. God doesn't love us because of who we are. He loves us because of who he is. Amen? That means he's never going to love you any more or any less than he loves you right now. And his love is not performance-based. It's not based on what you do for him. It's based on what he did for you. Hello, somebody. That's why he sent Jesus. Romans chapter 5, verse 8. God demonstrated. He showed us. He put on a demonstration. Just like when you go to the fair. I love going to the fair in the summer and eating all the good food. And a lot of times they have demonstrations, whether somebody's selling pots and pans or selling steak knives or whatever, right? They do a demonstration. And that's what God did. He demonstrated his love for us when he sent Jesus while we were still sinners. We didn't do anything to deserve his goodness. Jesus died for us. I want to say you something else about God's love that is so massive for us to grab a hold of today. And it is that God loves you, Amanda, just as much as he loves Jesus. And if we ever grasp how powerful that is, it changes our lives forever. It changes the way we see ourselves. It changes the way we value ourselves. It changes the way we make decisions. It changes the way we look at the world around us and the way we see others. That God loves you just as much as he loves Jesus Christ. Some of you, depending on your background, you might think, "Matt, Josh, that's almost blasphemous. How can you even say something like that?" And I can say it because Jesus said it. And it was one of his final prayers before he went to the cross. And he's praying to his Father in heaven. He's praying to God. And here's what he says in John 17, 23. He prays that the world will know. Everybody say no. The world will know that you sent me. He wants you to know today that God sent him to this earth. And here's what he wants you to know. That you, God, love them, that's us, as much as you love me. Jesus himself said that God the Father loves you just as much as he loves his own son, Jesus. Can I tell you today, you are so valuable to God. You are so important to God. You know how important you are to him? He was willing to exchange the life of his son for your life. He wanted you that bad. I love everybody in this room today. None of y'all doubt how much I love you, but I would never give my children in exchange for you. Facts, right? And you wouldn't do that for me. But God loved us so much, he gave the sinless for the sinful. And I love that about our God. The Bible actually says we can love him, Missy, because we understand that he's loved us. He loves you as much as he loves Jesus. And here's what that means. If he gave his son for you, if the price he paid, Kathy, for your soul, for your life, for you to enjoy not only what you have on this earth, but what he's going to give you in heaven, if the price he paid for your soul was the blood of his own son, Jesus Christ, then that means your life is worth the blood of Jesus. Your life is equal in the eyes of God to the value of his own son. Somebody's going to get this in a minute. Your life is of equal value to God as Jesus' life is. Come on, somebody. I am of equal value to God than Jesus is. That's huge. That's how God sees me. When are we ever going to start seeing ourselves that way? So much of the time we look in the mirror and we see what we're not. God looks at you and he sees what you are. He sees what you can be. He sees the reasons why he created you. He sees what Jesus already bought and paid for you to become in your life. He sees you as complete. He's not going to give up on you. He loves you too much to let you go. Come on, somebody. You know what I'm talking about today. He loves you. And that's so powerful for us to grab a hold of and understand. And that's why when Jesus went to the cross after 33 and a half years of sinless living on this earth, he died with his arms wide open and his palms open. You know why? Because he was saying, I love you this much. I love you so much, I refuse to do life without you. I'd rather die for you than live without you. The second simple message that Christmas sends to us is simply this. Number one was, God says, I love you. Number two, God says to you, I am for you. Come on, look at your neighbor and tell him, I'm for you. Tell your other neighbor, I'm in your corner. And so is God. And that's what we've got to know today, that God loves you. God's in your corner. God is for you. This is hard for us to grab a hold of. This is hard for us to understand. It's even hard for us to accept. But this is exactly what the Bible teaches about Jesus' coming, is that God showed us. He wanted to prove to you. He's like, what can I do to show them that I am for them and I'm not against them, that I believe in them and that they can lower their guard and believe in me, that I love them and they can love me back? Jesus is in your corner. Nobody wants you to succeed more than God does. Jesus said in John 10:10, he said, the thief comes to steal, kill, and destroy. But watch this. He said, I came so that they, somebody say, that's me. I came so they can have real and eternal life, more and better life. There's Mo Better again. More and better life, Mo Better life than they ever dreamed of. That's what Jesus came to give you. That's what Jesus wants for you. That's the desire of God's heart. He is for you. He's not against you. He is Emmanuel. He came to help us, not to hurt us. Emmanuel means he's God with us. God literally came to us. And here's what happens. Cody, we shy away from God because of the guilt of our sin, right? From the beginning of creation. In the Garden of Eden, when Adam and Eve sinned, what did they do? They went and hid from God. They stopped talking to him, and they covered themselves up. And there's something about sin in human nature that we have never stopped doing that. We run from God because of the guilt of sin. But God is saying, I want you to run to me, not from me. I want you to think about every sinner. The Bible says that when Jesus was on this earth, he hung out with sinners, with tax collectors, with prostitutes, with drunkards. He was with them so much that the religious folks said, he's one of them. Think about that. He was around them all the time. There was not one sinner who was afraid to come near to Jesus. When you have a revelation, Jim, of who Jesus really is, and you understand that he's for you, these people who were outcasts, these people who knew they were sinners, they were drawn to Jesus. They got to see Jesus. They heard him, and they wanted to be with him. And when we do that today, church, when you have a revelation of who Jesus is and that he's for you, you'll never run from him again. You will always run to him, no matter what's going on in your life, no matter where you're at. I'm talking to somebody today who's struggling in the secret areas of your life, and I want you to know today, no matter how bad you're struggling, God loves you and God is for you, and he doesn't want you to run from him. No matter what you've done, no matter where you've been, no matter what you're going through, the only way to fix it is to keep running to Jesus. And here's the thing that blows my mind. I can run to him because he ran to me. When I couldn't get to him, he came to me. He came to me when my sin had stopped. He said, I'm not going to let anything stop me. Look at that. A virgin birth? Are you kidding? He went through all that because he loves you and because he's for you. And that's why he went all in when it came to showing you his love. We're all guilty. That's the reality. Amen? We're all guilty. The Bible says we've all sinned, Sarah, and fallen short of God's best. We're all guilty of sin. That's why he sent Jesus. So get over your sin and get into righteousness and just enjoy doing life with Jesus. Amen? Come on, somebody. Number one, God loves you. For those of you watching right now online, number two, God loves you. Number one, he loves you. Number two, he's for you. Right? You want to do this? He loves you. He's for you. Number three, let's get into the final one. Number three right here is that God says to you through his gift, I want the very best for you. I love you. I'm for you. I want the best for you. So many times people think religion has taught us that God is this penny-pinching, angry, mean miser. This is old man with a long white beard, and he carries a big billy club, and he can't wait to thump you over the head every time you screw up. He looks at your life under a microscope, and he can't wait to dangle your soul over hell. Right? But that's a lie from the devil. The devil has perverted who God really is. He loves you. He's for you. He wants nothing less than his best for you. And the only way you can get that is to run to him. Your best life begins with Jesus Christ. Amen? Your best life, the life you've dreamed of, the life you lay in bed at night imagining yourself living, it begins with Jesus Christ. That's why Jesus came to us, because he wants nothing less than the best for you. You say, Josh, I believe that for my neighbor. I believe that for somebody like you, but I can never believe that for myself. And what we do is we start discounting God's blessing in our life. And it's not that God doesn't want what's best for you. It's that you won't allow him to give it to you because you say, well, I've done this and I've done that, and God must be angry with me, and God doesn't want me to have X, Y, and Z. But I know he wants what's best specifically for you. Here's why. Because he said, in his best to you. If he didn't want what was best for you, he wouldn't have sent his best to you. God sent his very best to you because he wants only the best for you. He sent the very best he could find when he sent Jesus. I don't remember what the commercial was, but it was basically communicating. It was about giving a gift, and it said, only send the best when you need the right message, right? What we give sends a message. God sent us his very, very best when he sent us his son, Jesus Christ. He says in Jeremiah chapter 29, verse 11, he says, I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord. Plans to prosper you and not to harm you. Plans to give you hope and a future. Hope and a future always go together. Your future needs you to hope. It needs you to believe that God wants what's best for you. It needs you to believe in 2020 that your best days are still ahead of you. It needs you to believe in 2020 that the rest of your life can be the best of your life. No matter what's going on in the world, no matter what's going on in the nation, you're a part of a kingdom, and you have a king that is greater than anything and supersedes anything you see in the natural. And he has promised victory. He has promised joy. He has promised provision. He has promised peace. He has promised life. Come on, somebody. Even in 2020, I keep my eyes on Jesus, and I have hope that the best is yet to come because of Jesus Christ. He says this in 1 Corinthians 2:9. He said, no eye has seen. Everybody point at your eyes. He said, no ear has heard. No, point at your ears. No mind has imagined. Touch your temple. What God has, past tense, prepared. It's already done. He's already prepared it for those who love him. Anybody love Jesus today? Come on. Any lovers of God in the house? But it was to us that God revealed these things by His Holy Spirit. I want the very best for my kids, and I am completely unapologetic about it. I don't care what anybody else thinks of me. I'm going to do everything I can. I'm going to spend every dollar I can. I'm going to do everything I can to let them know that I love them, and I'm for them, and I believe in them, and nobody will ever be a bigger cheerleader than I am, and I will always be there when they need me. I never want them to doubt that. And that's exactly what God the Father wants for you. When He sent Jesus, He wanted you to know without a shadow of a doubt that He loves you, that He's here for you, that He'll never leave you and He'll never forsake you, that He wants nothing less than the very best for you. He will always support you and be by your side. That's what your Father in heaven desires for you. He says, I love you, I'm for you, and I want the very best for you. 1 Timothy chapter 2, verse 5 says it like this. There is one God. I don't care what the world tells you. There is one God. And Christ Jesus is the only one who can bring us to Him. Jesus was truly human, and He gave Himself to rescue all of us. That baby born in a manger that we celebrate at Christmas would live a sinless life for 30 years. As He would step into ministry and perform His first miracle at the age of 30, for the next 3.5 years, He would do the things you read about in your Bible. And at the end of that time, He would be nailed to a cross and become the sinless sacrifice for you and for me. Why did He have to die? Very simply because our sin demanded that somebody pay the price. The Bible says the wages of your sin is death. But Jesus stepped in and He paid the price for our sin. He died our death so that we could live His life. He took our curse so that we could have His blessing. And 3 days later, God raised Him from the dead, and He's alive today. And anybody who believes that can be born again, can have a brand new life, can have the hope of knowing Jesus Christ, not only in this life, but in the life to come. And there's three things Jesus wants to hear back from you today. Number one, He wants to hear, Jesus, I believe. Somebody say, I believe. He wants to hear you say, I believe. He wants you to believe in His sinless death. He wants you to believe in the resurrection. He wants you to believe that He loves you and that He's for you and that He only wants what's best for you. The Bible says in Romans 3:24, it says, God did it for us. Out of sheer generosity, He put us in right standing with Himself, a pure gift. He got us out of the mess we're in and restored us to where He always wanted us to be. And He did it by means of Jesus Christ. God sacrificed Jesus on the altar of the world to clear the sin, world of sin. Having faith in Him, believing in Him, it sets us in the clear. It erases our sins. Somebody say, I believe.
I believe.
The second thing God wants to hear from you this Christmas is, not only Jesus do I believe, but Jesus I receive. Somebody say, I receive.
I receive.
It's not enough to believe it. You've got to receive it. It's a gift. And when you give a gift to somebody, they have to receive it. They have to open it. They have to use it. And that's what God says to you. It's not enough to just believe. He says, I want you to receive what I've given you. John chapter 1, verse 12, it says, yet to all who received Him, to those who believed in His name, He gave the right to become children of God. You say, well, Josh, how do I receive Jesus? It's as simple as ABC. A, admit you've sinned. It's what separated us all from God. B, believe in your heart that He died on the cross and God raised Him from the dead 3 days later. And C, confess, say with your mouth, Jesus, You're the Lord and Savior of my life. I believe and I receive. And the third and final thing God wants to hear from every single one of us this Christmas. This message is not for entry-level people into the kingdom of God. This message is for all of us, no matter how long you've been saved. He wants to hear you say, Jesus, I surrender. Jesus, I give You my life because that's what You gave to me. You gave me Your best, and I want to give You in return my best every single day. I love You, and I need You, and I surrender to You. Have you surrendered your life to Jesus? I'm not talking about your get out of hell free pass getting punched. I'm talking about where you're so grateful for what Jesus did for you that every day you get up and you give Him your life and you say, Lord, today I surrender my life to You. I give You my life as a gift for what You gave to me. And Lord, I want You to not only live in me, but I want You to live through me, through my attitudes, through the actions I choose, through the words I speak,
Jesus, forgive through me. Love through me. Heal through me. Deliver through me. Make a difference through my life. I thank you for what you did in me. Help me to do that for somebody else. If you'd stand to your feet this morning, have you done those three things? Have you said to God, I believe in you? Have you said to Jesus, Jesus, I receive you? And have you made that commitment, God, I surrender to you? Maybe your walk with God is not where you want it to be and you're struggling. Today is the day to get that right. It's a fact that Jesus Christ came 2,000 years ago. We mark history by what life was like before Jesus and by what life is like after Jesus, Cody. BC and AD. Jesus came. It's a historical fact. And it's the same in our life. What life was like before Jesus and what life was like after Jesus. And the most important thing I want to say to you today is simply this. The fact that he came once, and we know he did, history tells it. Believers and non-believers alike mark history off of his arrival and his birth. The fact that he came once is the greatest proof we have that he's coming back again. Some of y'all just had a major light bulb moment right there. Like, wow. I mean, we think that he's coming back is like this thing that's so distant. But he showed up one starry night, unexpected. And he's coming back again. In the darkness of night that we live in, the light of the world is going to show up. And he's going to split the eastern sky. And the trumpet of God is going to sound. And the dead in Christ are going to rise first. And we who are alive and remain will be caught up together with him in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. And we're going to have a time and a half. We're going to have a heavenly hoedown in the sky. We're going to enjoy the marriage supper of the Lamb. We're going to see the places he's created for you and for me. And most of all, we're going to be with Jesus. Are you ready? Are you ready with every head bowed and every eye closed? I want to ask you that today. Are you ready? It's never too late. Don't let the devil tell you that. And you're never too far gone. If you're here today and you say, Josh, this is my first time coming to church. Or if you're watching online, you say, Josh, this is the first time I've ever heard the real Christmas story. And I believe today. And I want to receive the gift you talked about through Jesus Christ. In just a moment, I'm going to count to three. And when I do, I want you to raise your hand. If you're at home, all I want you to do is type the word Jesus into that bar on Facebook Live. Somebody's going to be with you in just a second here. If you're here today and you say, Josh, today, I need to recommit my heart and life to Jesus. I believe and I've received, but you know what? I'm not living surrendered to him every day. I'm not allowing him to be first in my life. And today I want to do that. I want him to be first. I want to know what he thinks before I put what I think. I want to know what he says before I look at what I say or what others say. I want to know what he wants before what I want. I want to decrease that he can increase. Today, Josh, I want to surrender my life to Jesus and give him my best because that's what he gave me. If either of those describe you, when I count to three, I just want you to slip your hand up. Today is about maximizing the gift he gave us. He loves you, he's for you, and he wants what's best for you. It begins with Jesus Christ. Here we go on the count of three. If that's you, just raise your hand and wave at me. Josh, today I need Jesus and I surrender to him. One, two, three. That's me. Thank you so much for your honesty. Thank you for your honesty over here. Is there somebody else here today? Josh, today I need Jesus. I believe and I want to receive. Well, Josh, I want to surrender my life fresh and new. I haven't been making him first. I haven't been giving him my best. But today I want to make that decision online. Just type the word Jesus right where you're at right now. Come on, church. Can we put our hands together and celebrate the hands and the decisions being made right now? I'm not a priest. You don't need me to get to God. But we're going to walk to him together. I want you to repeat this prayer after me, praying it from your heart. Say, Heavenly Father, I come to you a sinner. And I need a Savior. Jesus, I believe. You came to this earth. You lived a sinless life. You died in my place at the cross for my sin. And 3 days later, God raised you from the dead. I declare you are my Lord. Forgive me of all my sin. Come into my heart. I give you my life. I believe, I receive, and I surrender take my life and use it to do something great for your glory. I thank you now. I am free, I am family, and I'm forgiven. In Jesus' name I pray. And all God's people said, amen. Come on, can we celebrate with the angels in heaven the decisions that were made this morning to make Jesus Christ your Lord and Savior? Our ushers have something for you. If you raised your hand and prayed that prayer, for those of you online, make sure you type that word Jesus. We'll send you a card that you can connect with us. We'd love to send that packet to you too. From the bottom of our hearts, welcome to the family. We're so grateful for your boldness and your decision you made today. Come on, church, one more time. Can we give God praise for that?
Yeah.
Amen. Listen, I hope y'all have the best Christmas you've ever had of your entire life. I believe it's possible. And so let's live every single day this week conscious of God's amazing gift for us. We always leave with a shout every week. Hallelujah on the count of three. Here we go. One, two, three.
Hallelujah.
God bless y'all. We can't wait to see you next Sunday. If you need prayer, our prayer team's waiting on you.